We're with Jan Bendor, and just tell us your title with the Michigan Election Reform Alliance.
I am a founding member of the Michigan Election Reform Alliance, and I'm currently the statewide coordinator for the group.
Okay, and what does MIRA, I guess is the acronym, what is MIRA doing in Michigan?
Well, our major concern is the protection of our election integrity. We have an election system that is riddled with problems and is very vulnerable to manipulation. We vote, but we can't really be sure our votes are being counted.
I know. I know that we talked off the record about some of the things that MIRA is doing legislative. Can you just mention a couple of items that MIRA is involved in?
We have a range of proposals. We have supported proposals for Election Day registration, which would allow people to register and vote on the same day. We have proposed that the state allow people to vote absentee without having to give an excuse, that voting by mail is essentially a right that people should have. Many people are very mobile. They're away from home in their job or study. This would be a major asset to getting more people to participate in voting. We have worked on ways to mitigate problems for people voting overseas, and we're definitely trying to address the really silly situation created by the Rogers Law that requires you to have the same address on your driver's license as on your voter registration. Because what that does is it puts people in real jeopardy, particularly students, when they have to have their residence be at school, yet their driver's license is still registered at home so that they're eligible for their parents' insurance. If they change that, they lose their insurance. We shouldn't be putting our citizens in that kind of a position. So we've made a number of proposals on the side of voters securing their right to vote. We've also tried to enforce the National Voter Registration Act, which requires definite steps be taken before anyone's registration can be purged. In the area of the security of our counting of votes, we've made a major proposal for auditing elections on both the night of the election and immediately afterward. And our audit proposal, called our post-election vote count audit proposal, would allow us to have confidence that the machines are not malfunctioning and that the results of the election are statistically reliable. And we can once again have faith that the right candidate was elected or the right ballot question was favored.
All right. The big question has been nationwide, really, to try to have, there's a lot of groups working on this, hand-counted paper ballots. Is your group in favor of having hand-counted paper ballots?
Ultimately, that may be where we go. We see the machines as a liability. They're not reliable, they're easily hacked, they create the illusion of certainty, and they certainly cost a lot of money. Every one of those tabulators in use in Michigan has been acquired at a cost of $6,000 to the taxpayers. And these things are only good for about 10 years, and they're basically overpriced 1970s election technology junk. If you look at them, they're slightly glorified test scanners. That's what they are. That's what you use when you take a test and fill in the bubbles. The memory card is a tiny, tiny little thing, 256K. So it's not even a computer by current standards. Why are we using this primitive technology and spending so much money on it? It makes no sense. So instead of replacing all of these very expensive devices that do almost nothing and are very easily hacked, we ought to seriously consider just simply going back to what most of the nations of Europe, Canada, are doing, and that is hand counting paper ballots.
Before she became Secretary of State, Ruth Johnson wrote a pretty scathing letter about the machines and their accuracy to the, I believe it was the Election Assistance Commission.
A federal body.
Yeah. So would she, do you think that you can make any headway with, at least while she's Secretary of State, with Ruth, Secretary of State Ruth Johnson, as far as possibly when the machines need to be replaced, maybe moving toward hand-counted paper ballots again so that we can, the state could save those millions of dollars that we're spending now on, I assume, maintenance and also the purchasing of the machines themselves?
Well, I have a lot of respect for the new Secretary of State. I've seen her work in her county of origin, Oakland County. She's done a lot of the right things. She's had the courage to speak up, which very few other officials have had. And she actually appeared in a movie, Hacking Democracy, with her staff, criticizing the unreliability of optical scan tabulators. So we're very optimistic that with all the pressures that are on her to save the state money, Ruth Johnson might well consider moves that will ultimately be economical for the taxpayers.
What are some of the other areas where our elections in Michigan are at risk, if you will?
We have almost no rules or laws that set up your basic security of election materials. The ballots, which are probably the most important in our elections. We have no chain of custody of ballots. We have no rules for chain of custody. From the time those ballots leave the printer's office, we have no tracking on them. They can go and get lost. There are many bad things you can do with blank ballots if you have evil intentions. And right now we have very little in place to prevent ballot stuffing, ballot replacement, ballot chaining. These are all forms of election fraud.
You were, I know there was an election in Detroit for mayor, and there were some issues involving that election. Just tell our readers real briefly, if you can, what the issues were there.
Well, in the recount for the mayoral race in the fall of 2009, we were able to observe a lot of problems in that election. The election workers who were brought in front of the board of canvassers to testify actually admitted to destroying blank ballots before the date when that was lawfully allowed. If you destroy any ballots before a recount is complete, you have no way to balance out the numbers or reconcile the numbers in a recount. Destruction of evidence is one major problem. There were many other problems. A key one was the breaking of seals, or the fact that seals did not agree in their serial number with the serial numbers that were written into the poll book. There were so many precincts where there were problems with broken seals and missing seals that precincts could not be recounted. In the number of ballots involved was 42,000 ballots that could not be recounted. That was more than the difference between the two candidates, which was 19,000 votes or ballots. So essentially you had an election that was completely invalid. If you cannot replicate the results of an election, it should not stand. That election should have been thrown out. We also saw evidence of other kinds of election irregularities and outright fraud. There were places where we could see that the same handwriting had filled in a number of ballots. There were write-in candidate names that were all spelled exactly the same way. Anybody who's run elections knows that write-in candidates, even when they do a good job of campaigning, don't get their names spelled the same by all their voters. you see a normal variation. Well, this was not normal. All of the names were exactly correct. So somebody had filled those ballots out somewhere in the same pen, and that was going on in a number of precincts.
Well, I think we talked off the record, too, that there was a reason. I guess there was a ballot or a bond proposal that was on the Detroit ballot, because you mentioned a number. I think it was 58% of the precincts could not be recounted in the city of Detroit. And so would you think that bond issue would be a factor that would play into the, if someone wanted to cheat, that would be a motivating factor for cheating?
Well, that's the reason you have election fraud, is because there are millions of dollars at stake. Nobody bothers to manipulate an election for an unpaid job like school board. It's always going to be where there's a lot of money at stake. And in this case, there was a huge vote that was very important. Borrowing that amount of money was going to put money in the pockets of lots and lots of contractors. So it was key to get it passed. Somebody had a big interest in getting that bond passed, and it probably wasn't the voters of Detroit, because everywhere else voters were turning down bond issues and millages.
And it resulted in a pretty hefty tax increase.
Huge tax increase. The last thing that city needs is to burden its citizens with more taxes.
What grade would you give the voting procedures and security in Michigan? You know, as I know you've been to a lot of national conferences. What grade would you give Michigan as far as comparing it to the rest of the country?
We have some things that we do very, very well. Our centralized voter data system, although it's rapidly becoming obsolete, it hasn't been updated for a long time, is still very good. So I would give our qualified voter file probably a grade of B. But everything else that we're doing is a D. We're not paying attention to the insecurity of our system. We're not paying attention to voter confidence in our system. The only thing keeping us from being a third world country is that we have blessedly a group of very dedicated election administrators at the local level, most of whom are absolutely determined to run honest elections. They take an oath and they take it very seriously, and they're able to find a lot of very dedicated election workers who work 15-hour days. But those people are getting up there in age, and we're not getting a lot of younger people coming in to do that. So our honor system, which is what our election system is right on the edge. It's right on the edge. We are really in danger of becoming a third world country in our elections.
Thanks.